Thanks so much for joining us on this warm and sunny Sunday morning here in British Columbia, Vancouver, British Columbia. We're from all parts of kind of Greater Vancouver and the Sunshine Coast. Delighted to have you with us worshiping at Brentwood Presbyterian Church. Just a reminder of how we see our missioning. We nourish souls to flourish in the mercy and grace of Jesus Christ through worship, learning, fellowship, and service. And so this is our Sunday morning worshiping. You will be muted for most of the service, simply because it gets a little noisy if we're unmuted. There's a chat box. We use that for the word to ponder. For those of you that are new with us this morning, before the sermon, we always have a conversation among the congregation as to the meaning of a particular word that you see. And so that you can use the chat box for that. And then we also use it for prayers of the people. But here's a sense of what we see, what we sense happening over the next hour each week. We believe that our triune creator welcomes us into a safe space, and that in that space we find hospitality, hope, and healing for conversations that nourish us to flourish, that worshiping is in fact a conversation with God and among each other. We wonder at the mercy and grace of Jesus, the Creator's Christ, that forgives and reconciles us. And that blessing then generates wisdom for our missioning, for our being ambassadors in the world of that forgiving and reconciling love, and that we're equipped to be witnessing partners with the Holy Spirit in caring for all of those portions of God's creation where we will be sent when we leave this gathering. So that in many ways, this is a gathering of the church, but the church is also all of us dispersed into our communities, sharing the kinds of conversations that we have here about God's mercy and grace in Jesus Christ. And so we see every one of you contributing to this event by your presence here with us. And so we are deeply, deeply grateful for that contribution and that presence. We do acknowledge and respect, with respect and gratitude, that our buildings sit on the traditional and unceded lands of the Musqueam, Squamish, and Tsleil-Waututh nations. The Presbyterian Church in Canada back in 1994 confessed to our misrepresentations of Jesus in our relations with our Indigenous kin. And so we pray that as we move forward into the future as ambassadors of God's forgiving and reconciling love, that we will move from sovereignty over to stewardship with in our mutual care of God's creation. And we are deeply grateful to Melanie Gleason Lyle, a local Indigenous artist, for giving us permission to use this image of hers, Stronger Together, that in some ways captures the range of races in the world and the diversity of countries and places of origin among those of us who gather as Brentwood Presbyterian Church. The wonderful piece written by Ben to draw us further into worship. Let's pray our welcomed into worship prayer together. You draw us here with welcoming love from neighborhoods of struggle and strife, bearing stress injuries of all kinds. And in the safety of this sanctuary, you heal us into greater wholeness, nourishing our souls to flourish in your mercy and grace. So in this time, in this place, at this point in our lives, inspire and equip us to be faithful, wise, and effective ambassadors of your forgiving and reconciling love. I was a little thrown there because the match lit on the first strike. I'm not used to that. Let's pray. Of all the wisdom that Paul knew about your intent, dear Lord, it is fascinating that he chose to focus on the promise of blessing made to Abraham and Sarah. Awaken us further to its significance this morning. Help us appropriate your blessing and apply it. And we say these words together, appreciating God's grace. Your merciful, grace-loving Trinity constantly works to transform our lives. You take us from wandering to wondering, from the dark to the light, from isolation to community, from confusion to clarity, from despair to joy, and from death to eternal life. Make us ever more grateful for this redemptive power in our lives, and guide us to represent your reconciling grace wisely to bless this world. This hymn is a version of the Beatitudes, and so we'll sing verses 3 and 4. Sing our prayer for illumination.
Speak, O Lord, as we come to you to receive the food of your holy word. Take your truth, plant it deep in us, shape and fashion us in your likeness.
And our reader this morning is the person you just heard singing, one of our music directors, Ben McCrae. Ben, you also hear Ben playing the clarinet in our music, and Dan Reynolds, our other music director, Dan plays the piano. So Ben usually reads on the second Sunday of the month. So here's Ben.
Good morning, everybody. Glad to see some new faces and to see some old ones as well. Our first reading is from Psalm 24, Entrance into the Temple, of David, a psalm. The earth is the Lord's and all that is in it, the world and those who live in it, for he has founded it on the seas and established it on the rivers. Who shall ascend the hill of the Lord, and who shall stand in his holy place? Those who have clean hands and pure hearts, who do not lift up their souls to what is false, and do not swear deceitfully. They will receive blessing from the Lord, and vindication from the God of their salvation. Such is the company of those who seek him, who seek the face of the God of Jacob. Lift up your heads, O gates, and be lifted up, O ancient doors, that the kingdom of glory may come in. And who is the kingdom of glory? The Lord, strong and mighty, the Lord, mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O gates, and be lifted up, O ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord of hosts. He is the King of glory. Our next reading is from Galatians chapter 3, verses 15 to 18. Just one moment. I have my book open to the wrong page. Galatians chapter 3, verses 15 through 18. The promise to Abraham. Brothers and sisters, I give an example from daily life. Once a person's will has been ratified, no one adds to it or annuls it. Now the promises were made to Abraham and to his offspring. It does not say, and to offsprings, as of many, but it says, and to your offspring, that is, to one person, who is Christ. My point is this: the law, which does not come 430 years later, does not annul a covenant previously ratified by God, so as to nullify the promise. For if the inheritance comes from the law, it no longer comes from the promise, but God granted it to Abraham through the promise. This is the written word of God, a witness to the living word, Jesus Christ, understood through the work of the Holy Spirit. Thanks be to God.
Thanks, Ben. So for those of you that are with us for the first time, this is a tradition that we have around Brentwood, where after the scripture reading, before the sermon, we have a conversation with each other about what a particular word, either in the reading or in the theme of the sermon, means for us. And it's rooted in a Presbyterian tradition, which sees the church being Jesus Christ and all of his people. So the wisdom that comes to us about Christ through the work of the Holy Spirit is something that we value and that we look forward to hearing every Sunday. And so please don't hesitate to write into the chat. Or if you unmute yourself by hitting the space bar, you can do that while you're speaking and then let the space bar up and we'll make a note of what you're saying. This is the graphic is a Cherokee prayer blessing by Susan Cummings. And if your screens are small and you're having difficulty seeing it, let me read it for you. May the warm winds of heaven blow softly upon your house. May the Great Spirit bless all who enter there. May your moccasins make happy tracks in many seasons. And may the rainbow always touch your shoulder. So, what's the idea of blessing? A reg gift from God for his glory and our benefit? Yeah. And Ben, Christ on the cross, love incarnate. So that whole theology of the cross, we see the kingdom of God, the kingship of God on the cross. That's Christ's throne. Grace, always available. Yes. And grace. Yeah. Blessing is the grace of God. Holy Spirit moving through us. Often not understood in its occurrence. Good point, Stephen. Actualizing God's love, the ongoing atonement of creation. Ah, and that atonement has that idea of at-one-ment, that the reconciliation idea that's there. Good catch, Ben. Thank you. Yeah, simply God's love, a promise fulfilled in our direct experience. Yes, it's that touching each of us at the very core of our being with this blessing that is so powerful. Often recognized in hindsight, yes, we do not perceive what is best for us. It is in God's hands. So it's often that sense of, I see. Well, as always, don't hesitate to continue to put ideas up in the chat box. I'll capture them at the end of the service. And then the sermon notes go up on the website. There's a section under learning on sermons. And the wisdom of the congregation is almost always, every now and then I mess up, but almost always captured and put into those sermon notes. So I really, really appreciate it. And June, one of the things that I find in this part of the service and with the conversation is that, and often I'll say quietly to myself and then out loud to the congregation, man, I wish I preached on that. That's a really good idea. However, we got lots of sermons to go. So thank you again for that. The piece of the passage that Ben read this morning that I wanted to pick up on and play around with a little bit this morning was the last verse. For in the inheritance, for the if the inheritance comes from the law, it no longer comes from the promise. But God granted it to Abraham through the promise. And so Paul is playing around again. He does this often in his writings, with this contrast between law and promise. Now, I'm fascinated by where people get their ideas. Where people get their ideas. Most of you know that for some time, I was a professor of church history, taught for a while as an adjunct faculty in Toronto at Knox College, University of Toronto, and then came out here in 1985 to be Dean of the Presbyterian College at UBC and teach at Vancouver School of Theology, was there for about 16 plus years. And my particular focus of interest as a church historian was the organizational development of the church and the leadership that shaped its trajectories in particular times and places. And the time and place that I did most of my research in was the Presbyterian Church in Canada in the late 19th and 20th centuries. But in that work, I'd dig deeply into the influences that formed and reformed, right? Because these ideas were constantly changing, formed and reformed the attitudes and behaviors that were exhibited by those leaders. What kind of ideas were they suggesting to people in the churches as to how to form themselves as ambassadors of God's forgiving and reconciling love in their time and in their place? And that fascination remains for me. So as we've been listening in on Paul's conversations with the leaders of the early churches, and that's what we, as we've said several times, that's how we see the letters that are printed in the New Testament, compiled in the New Testament. These are parts of a broader conversation Paul is having with other church leaders, with people who are either have committed to the church or are interested in the church, about what it means to inherit this promise of Abraham, this promise of the treaty, of the covenant, of the mutual benefit agreement with God, that we will be blessings in the world. That's the heart of the promise. I'll be your God so you can be a blessing in the world. That, for Paul, going back to Abraham, was the essence of the promise. So I'm curious about where Paul gets his ideas, what influences the form of his approach. How does he see the building up of this community that God is calling to model a new way of being human? Christ is the first fruits of the new humanity. Now, all of the indications are that Paul was a distinguished Jewish scholar. He'd been chosen by the authorities of his religious tradition to use that learning to refute and remove the followers of this upstart rabbi called Jesus, who'd stirred up turmoil that threatened the accommodations of those authorities with the Roman imperial powers. It's likely that he studied with a distinguished Pharisee scholar by the name of Gamaliel. Gamaliel's school was in Jerusalem. It was very prominent in the first century. Gamaliel was a descendant of Hillel. He was a member of the ruling council, the Sanhedrin of the temple. Now, as is the case with so many of these figures in the Bible, we don't have a lot of details. I mean, there's a few scattered references to him from which we can make some assumptions. But we don't have a lot of details about Gamaliel's teachings and life. But the education of Pharisees, we know, was very thorough. I mean, it was a deep dive into the traditions of the Jewish law. And in particular, the Pharisees thought that all Jewish people should observe the laws and rituals of purification, and that these laws and rituals set them apart from others. So, out of all of the traditions that Paul had studied, and that Paul, in fact, practiced, I find it intriguing that in his arguments with other leaders in the early church. And we've seen in our Bible study, Wednesday at 2 o'clock, we get together for Bible study. We call ourselves the rabbit hole gang because you never know where the spirit, which rabbit hole the spirit's going to take us down in those conversations. But as we talked about this Wednesday, and Reg Molnar was great in leading us down these particular rabbit holes, Paul goes back over and over again to the promise of blessing made to Abraham and Sarah. And he sees that as the definitive promise for understanding the intent of God. And it's really a key point of contention in the New Testament. Is the promise made to Abraham, or is the law given to Moses, the definitive factor in our relationship with God? Is it law or gospel? Is it a gift of grace, our relationship with God, or is it a reward for compliance? Is it companionship or conformity? Those are ways of talking about what seem to be the alternatives. Now, for Paul, after his encounter with the living Christ on the Damascus Road, as he sorts out the significance of his awakening to the fact that Jesus is, in fact, the Christ, the Jewish Messiah, he keeps going back to this idea of the promise to Abraham, and recognizes Christ as the final fruition of the seed of Abraham. And in that seed has come to fruition the promise of being part of God's blessing of the whole world. And so for Paul, the invitation from God is to become a part of God's blessing of the whole world. That's what we're about as church. Every conversation you have, every encounter you have, whoops, nice catch, is an opportunity to be a blessing, to be an ambassador of God's forgiving and reconciling love. That's how we bless the world, to be ambassadors of that grace and that mercy. Now, I think it's important to remember that neither Jesus nor Paul were rejecting their Jewish tradition. They were proclaiming a God who would act decisively in Jesus to fulfill the promise made to Abraham, to fulfill the legacy that Abraham left for the people of Israel, to be a blessing to all nations, to all peoples and their lands. What they were doing was challenging the misrepresentation of that promise, the misrepresentation of who God was and what God was doing, a misrepresentation that sought to prevent and exclude a wide variety of peoples from the benefits of the covenant, that treaty of mutual benefit that God made with Abraham and Abraham's family and Abraham's seed down through the generations. Paul's deep engagement with the Jewish tradition had a parallel in some ways with Jesus' study of the Jewish faith and the Jewish tradition. Many scholars assume that 30 years that was spent, that we don't know much about between birth and public mission, was spent in a deep study of the Jewish tradition, obviously, because Jesus understands it so fully, so deeply, so powerfully. And there are some, no evidence of it, but there are some who speculate that Jesus himself was a student of Gamaliel. But Jesus also focused on that promise to Abraham, especially in the way in which the prophets picked up that promise to Abraham. and in their own way, in their own day, called the Jewish people back to that way of being with God. Being with God as partners, as companions, as contributors to God's blessing of the creation. And so Paul's deep engagement with the Jewish tradition led him to value the promise of blessing made with Abraham above all other aspects of that tradition, and to see in that promise, in Jesus' summary of the law and the prophets, love God, love others, love yourself, right, which is really a promise of blessing to the whole of creation, to see that as the key to what it meant to be an ambassador of God's forgiving and reconciling love. And so they recognized that the promise was not just for the Jews. It was made to the Jews for the sake of the whole of creation. That's what Christ was calling his people back to. Now, the first century Pharisaic emphasis on separation and purity in the minds of Jesus and Paul misrepresented that promise. Jesus' embodiment of a kinship of justice, justice practiced with kindness and humility throughout all of creation, was the true fruition of this seed of Abraham, of this promise to Abraham. And living into that promise brought such well-being to the whole world, that was far more important than a rigid compliance with people's interpretation of the law. Indeed, the promise was really the purpose of the law. And it should be understood as serving the intent of blessing the whole of creation. And when it didn't, it had to be challenged and reformed, as Jesus and Paul were doing, and as they invite us to do. I mean, in many ways, we face a similar choice in the churches today. There are modern day leaders who presume they know what the pure gospel is. Leaders who insist on compliance and conformity to their understanding of God's will. And often that sense of purity leads to a hurtful exclusion that's based on presumptions of purity, and I would say on the multiplication of injustices. Because I stand with Paul and Jesus, at least as I understand them, in challenging the way of being ambassadors of God's mercy and grace that are revealed in the saving event of Jesus, the triune creator's Christ. It's that open invitation to align with God and blessing the whole of creation. That's the message that we take into the world when we disperse from worshiping this morning. That message is one of blessing, of God's forgiving and reconciling love for all peoples of the world and for all of their lands. That's the inheritance of Abraham that Paul was pointing to this morning in our text. It's an inheritance that's worth continuing to live into. Amen. Ben and Dan have a wonderful piece of music this morning for reflection. Who could imagine a king?
Thank you.
Thanks so much, Dan and Ben. Indeed, who could imagine a king who chose a cross for his throne? So this is a declaration that we have composed here at Brentwood, a recalling, a remembering of the story of God's saving mercy and grace that kind of takes us through the sweep of that narrative in the scriptures. And so we say it together, read it together every Sunday. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth and declared them to be very good. God then created humanity in all of our diversity to cultivate blessing throughout the world. Rejecting the limits of their power, our ancestors rebelled against God's vision of goodness. And by continuing to rebel against God's constraints, we compound the pain of toil, tyranny, trauma, and death. But God never gave up, as the Spirit reveals in the scriptures. In a definitive act of reconciling forgiveness, God became incarnate among us. In the life, death, resurrection, and ascension of Jesus of Nazareth, God restored the original goodness of creation as a commonwealth enjoyed on earth as it is in heaven. The Holy Spirit continues to work out the fulfillment of that act. Through the Church Universal in which we participate, the Holy Spirit nourishes us to flourish as God's friends through worship, learning, fellowship, and service. By God's grace in Jesus the Christ, through the Holy Spirit, we know what it is to be loved and to love amidst all the problems of the world. And we are equipped, empowered, and sent to sow the seeds of God's peace in all of our circles of influence. In the end, God's love will transform the heavens and the earth and bring justice, peace, and joy to every dimension of creation. So just a few comments about some of the things going on around Brentwood, even over the summer. Next week, July the 18th, our session will meet, our governing board will meet. We always meet along with the staff at this stage in our Zoom boardroom to support the well-being of the congregation's missioning. And if there's any ideas that you would like to have us consider, don't hesitate to email. You can email Pam Wong, who's our clerk of session. Her email comes up a little later. You can email myself. You can email to brentwoodpcc@gmail.com, which is the church's common email. So don't hesitate to raise anything you'd like us to take a look at. And we will be deciding at that meeting when we come back together, when it's safe and prudent to come back together in person. We have, from the beginning of the trend of the pandemic, have been cautious and prudent, so we'll make sure that it's safe. And there's lots of advice out there from our national offices and from our public health people as to when and how is safe to come back together, but we're looking forward to that. If you know family or friends, or if you happen to have guitars yourselves to donate to our Gospel with Guitars program that we're doing with Inner Hope Youth Ministries in Vancouver's East End, please let me know. Program's going to be run by our own ruling elder, Rita Long, supported by Nate Hartley. Nate's a student for ministry in the Presbyterian Church in Canada who works with Inner Hope. And then Reverend Heinrich Botha of West Vancouver Presbyterian Church. He's also a guitar tech, and so he's going to be looking after the guitars in the program. So it's a kind of neat collaboration. Rita, do you want to unmute and say a little bit about it?
Sure. I have to say that these little classes are like an outgrowth of many years of kind of research and experience. And there is definitely a benefit to one-on-one study, but when you get a group of like-minded people together, the bonds that form so quickly are amazing. And it's often once you set up the environment and just let it run. So our intention is to spoil these kids rotten right away so they can walk into a beautiful setup workshop and then let them just run with it with our direction. The program is co-creative. So when we go for the day, roughly 4 hours, the first module is mine, a teacher's choice. And then after that, there are several selections of 10 essential guitar skills. And then the students get to choose. So they co-create the day with the instructor the whole time. And I found this to be just absolutely super enjoyable for all concerned. Looking forward to getting started. And the cross-pollination of ideas from Nate and Heinrich were amazing, even to the point of suggesting future apprenticeships for people that can't go to university, for example, that guitar technology right now is very in demand. You can't keep the guitars in tune. Even where I work at Long and McQuaid, we're cycling through techs that go off and start their own business. So we're on the third one now. And we have to keep refilling the person who's doing the tech work. So we're training constantly. So one is sort of Glora idea, like as an outgrowth of this class, would be perhaps one of those students would decide to become a guitar tech, which is just strictly full apprenticeship style. So that's our big hope, but we'll start with getting the kids together and see what happens from there. Very excited.
That's great. Thanks for bringing this to it. One of the ways in which we see ourselves, June, we work a lot with the music community, particularly the jazz community. You may have noticed that from our website, but the whole idea is to create space for these kinds of things to happen. And this is a collaboration with Trinity Grace United Church. They're over near Fraser and Kingsway, so Inner Hope Youth Ministries is close to them, so that's where we'll do the workshop. Then Rita's going to go over to their facilities and do one-on-one lessons with the students. And our attitude is, let's just create the space for this to happen, and who knows what the Spirit will do with it. So we've got some funding from our national church, a fund from our national church to do the fall. Trinity Grace is going to kick in the money to do the spring. And if it goes as well as we hope, then there should be some ongoing funding from a variety of sources for this kind of work. So Rita, thanks so much for all the work you've put into it. And I'm delighted that the synergy between you, Nate, and Heinrich is working out so well. Just a reminder of some of the regular things that happen. We do our Bible study on call it the rabbit hole gang, because who knows what rabbit holes we're going to go down on a particular Wednesday. It's always the text that we're looking at for the sermon for the following week. It's an amazingly diverse and broad-ranging conversation, but you're more than welcome to join us for that. The prayer group has been meeting on Saturday mornings at 10 o'clock. We're going to take the summer off and figure out when and how we resume that in the fall. And I just want to again emphasize this reality that we recognize at Brentwood, and that is that each and every one of you in the circles of influence and fellowship and service that you go into during the week as you live out the nine teachings of the apostles, we sing those near the end of the service in all of your relationships, that's really what the church is. That's really who and what the church is. It's you in your daily lives being those ambassadors of God's forgiving and reconciling love. And our prayer is that our time together on a Sunday morning or any other time that we gather nourishes you to flourish in that calling. We do appreciate the ways in which you are contributing to God's generosity through Brentwood. You can send checks to the church. You can send an e-transfer to Pam. There's her email, pamwong76@yahoo.ca. Or you can use the donate button on our Canada Helps page. And we've already got a suggestion to look at next Sunday. There's a process of donating on a regular basis called PAR, prearranged. I can't remember what the R stands for. We'll take a look at whether we can set that up for folks as well. So thanks for that suggestion. One of the wonderful songs from the first part of our hymn book with the Psalms, "Let Us With a Gladsome Mind." As we consider our prayers of the people, please again use the chat box to articulate any prayers that you would like us to consider. We do want you to take note that sometimes in those prayers, we do make reference to traumatic events, and we want you to be aware that of that. So our prayers for this morning. Reg is remembering Rick Thompson again. Rick is a friend of Reg's who continues to wait. It's long months now, but for a double hand transplant. We have friends in Kamloops and friends in Vernon, both of whom are facing possible evacuation due to the wildfires that are raging up there. And so with that connection, we remember all those in that region who are both the people in Lytton who are now just beginning to see the devastation that's taken place through that wildfire and the others. And we pray for especially for all those who are providing or fighting the fires, who are providing shelter for those who have to evacuate. We remember them. Reg's friend Francis, who's the son of residential school survivors, remembering the trauma that gets passed on there from generation to generation. And lots of friends and family within the congregation and connected with the congregation who are dealing with health concerns, treatments for cancer, surgeries, COVID. And Reg, all residential school families. Yeah, a particular. Next week, I should have mentioned in the announcements, but next week in we'll be doing our interview sermon once a month. We have a person to interview and bring some perspective into these conversations we're having with Paul. Next week is Carmen Lansdowne, Reverend Dr. Carmen Lansdowne. She's the executive director of First United Church Community Mission Society, one of Canada's leading Indigenous theologians. So we're looking forward to that. But she's become a very articulate spokesperson for as we confirm the number of unmarked graves that we find around residential schools, so and the way in which that's re-traumatizing families generations later. Children dealing with food insecurity and being homeless and before retirement, Pam worked with the Surrey School Board in their nutrition programs. And so that's a particular, that sense of food insecurity is a particular concern for Pam. And what we've heard with the disruptions in Haiti, with the disruptions in Afghanistan, in the Middle East, the kinds of food insecurity that children around the world are facing. Clean water in our indigenous communities. We do some charity concerts for water providing charity in Africa. So it's just these little things that we so often take for granted that are just not there in so many parts of the world. So thank you for all of these prayers. Gracious God, we commend to your care the prayers that we have expressed out loud, the prayers that are in the quiet of our own souls, prayers for our awakening to your mercy and grace, prayers for the ways in which we might become avenues, instruments of that mercy and grace in every encounter that we have. We give thanks for your coming to us, for you taking the initiative in awakening us to the ways in which you would like to see us live together on the land that you have provided in ways that bless the whole of this creation. Spark our imaginations for new ways of living into that blessing, of sharing that blessing with everyone that we meet. And with the focus on that blessing this morning, help us hear the words that you taught us in the person of Jesus as we pray.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and
unmute myself. This is our summary of the fruits of the Spirit, as Paul outlines them in Galatians. And we sing it through three times as we come to the close of our time together in worship.
Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, gentleness, self-composure. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, self-composure.
And when we live into those fruits of the Spirit, those gifts of the Spirit, compose ourselves around those gifts, then we truly are blessings in all of our circles of influence and inspiration. Remind us often, dear Lord, whenever we need it most, of your promise of steadfast and eternal blessing as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
blessing, nourished by your loving grace. We're equipped to live your story, heard so clearly in this place. Guide us by your loving wisdom as we flourish for your hands. Bring us back together safely, having been your loving friends.
Just a quick acknowledgement of the sources for today's images. All of these artists have given us permission to use their images. There's a couple we've requested, haven't heard back from, but we are deeply grateful for the richness that their art provides for our worshiping. And thanks again for participating with us. You can find out more about our missioning. You can visit our website. And if you want to get your name put on our weekly emails, then just email us at brentwoodpcc@gmail.com. Make that request and we'll make sure that your name gets onto the weekly list. Thanks again for joining us.